What's up, Wizards? Deb from The Place with some fun content. I just wanted to kind of bang out tonight because we have got the entire set spoiler for Doctor Who. We got it a couple of days ago, and I actually have been taking some time to look over it and see what I like, what I don't like, some cards people aren't talking about, some blah, blah, blah. So today, we're going to talk about the top 10 cards, in my opinion, the ones that I'm most excited for from Doctor Who. Now, that doesn't mean the top 10 strongest cards or anything like that. As far as this set goes, I'm just looking at the cards that I, again, am the most hype about, which might be completely different from the top 10 most powerful cards in the set. And there's a bunch of stuff in here to get kind of hype about, whether you're a commander player or a cube player. I am a little bit of both. So, you know, you see stuff like Dalek Drone for Cube, and this isn't even an honorable mention. This is just one of the cards I kind of don't have time to talk about, but I'm still going to make time for. Dalek Drone isn't going to replace Shriek Maw or Ravenous Chupacabra in your Cube anytime soon. Probably not, but it is a cool little creature like that, right? And I actually think there's a ton of value on this thing, so I wanted to shine some spotlight on it because I don't think anybody else is going to do that. But aside from that, Missy is an awesome-looking commander that I'm pretty sure everyone's going to be talking about, right? So I don't want to devote too much time to her here, but yes, this is an evil little Grixis commander that I think is probably going to see a lot of play before it's all said and done. But let's actually get into the cards that I did make time to actually talk about tonight and see if I can talk about them or not. There's some of these cards I'm going to go ahead and let you know right up front. The first, like, half of the list I just think are cool cards. I don't know that I have that much to say about them. And then, like, the last five cards, the latter half of the list, that's the stuff I'm going to be, like, throwing out commander things you can do for, right? Because I've really been thinking about those a lot. But like I said, the set is chock full of cards that I can't stop thinking about. I have two honorable mentions this time around, and that's because I really couldn't choose between them. There's Barbara Wright and Ian Chesterton, all right? You'll see why I couldn't choose between these in a second. They don't do the same thing, but, you know, Barbara is 2 mana, 1 and a white for a 1/3 legendary human advisor. It's got history teacher. Sagas you control have read ahead. And also have Daughter's Companion. You can have 2 commanders if the other commander is the doctor. So like a form of partner here. But I'm not even that worried about that. What I like is Sagas You Control Have Read Ahead. That is pretty sick. In like a Tom Bombadil deck or just anything with Sagas. Giving any Saga Read Ahead is very, very awesome. As far as Ian goes, 3 mana, 2 and a white for a 2/3 legendary human scientist with science teacher. Each saga spell you cast has replicate. The replicate cost equal to the mana cost. So when you cast the saga, you copy it for each time you pay the replicate cost. And this also has Doctor's Companion, so you can have 2 commanders if the other is a doctor. This is arguably way cooler even than Barbara. I like Read Ahead, man. That's a really cool ability to add to each and every one of my sagas. But now I can just double, triple cast my sagas. You know, if I have 6 mana, I can cast Teachings of Kieran like 3 times. Let's go, dude. That is so cool, man. Even like 3 and 4 mana sagas. Oh, I just have to have 9 mana in Commander to triple a 3 mana saga. I can probably pull that off, especially late in the game. So I think Ian is really, really cool, man. Late game, even not that late game, like turn 3 you play Ian, turn 4 you can replicate a 2 mana saga. Like, that's sick. Even in Commander I think that's sick. So I like Ian and Barbara a lot. I'm not a huge fan of like sagas in Commander or saga commanders. I didn't freak out about like Tom Bombadil as much as I saw a lot of people freaking out about him. But, you know, each set that goes by, it feels like they give us a new thing for sagas and commanders. So I'm slowly starting to come around to, like, maybe this can really actually work. So a couple of cool cards here. Now, I'm going to go ahead and get to the actual list here. But quick note before we do, because my voice sounds different to me as I talk. So if my voice sounds different to you, it's because I was sick all last week. You know, I'm still getting over it. My throat hurts a little bit. So I apologize that it's not the same dulcet tones that you're used to here on the channel, but I'll try to keep it smoother than your sister's hips as we move through these cards. So let's get to number 10 here. Sorry for that image. It's Cybermat. I'm a sucker for artifact aggro, like in Commander. I know it's not like Affinity or anything, but like I like my artifact creatures in Commander an awful lot, so I like Cybermat. This is 2 mana for a 2/1 robot artifact creature with Skulk, and it kind of looks like a Roomba in terms of the function. But anyway, the rest of the card reads, whenever Cybermat attacks and isn't blocked, it gets +X/+0 until end of turn, where X is the number of attacking artifact creatures. So it gives itself like a pseudo cranial plating-ish type. Not quite, but like it's almost, you see where I'm going with it, right? But it has to not be blocked. So you usually are going to have to devise a way for this to go unblocked or to be unblockable or whatever. So you have to probably do a little bit of work to get this to work, but on a field full of dudes, I could see this actually being amazing. You know, like if you, in your Urtet deck, is that the guy's name? Is that the guy's name? Yes, actually, I think I got it right for once. the Mir, five-color Mir commander. Who is usually used as a five-color commander, I think. But, you know, you got your choice of five-color commanders, and I think if all you want to do is cheese five colors, you could probably do way better than Urtet. So, assuming you're using him for his actual function, then a card like this could be really sweet because you're presumably going to be attacking with a ton of artifact creatures because you got all those little Murs that you pooped out. So, this actually looks sweet in a deck like that, or pretty much anything artifact aggro related, right? Like if you're building Liberator versus Battlethopter or something like that, this could work. So I'm not sure it's the best card in the world. That's why it's number 10, but it is one that caught my eye and I don't think anybody else is talking about. So I wanted to shine a light on it. I like it. But speaking of Urtet, let's look at number 9, which is not necessarily a similar card, but it goes in the same decks, right? Let's take a look at Cyberman Patrol. This is 2 mana for an artifact creature. It's a Cyberman. It's a 2/2. Artifact creatures you control have afflict 3. What is that? I haven't seen afflict in 15 years, or more than that, actually. Whenever a creature with afflict 3 becomes blocked, defending player loses 3 life. That's not too bad. Again, in Urtet decks, the exact same decks, you got a bunch of stupid little Murs out, and they're dorky, you know, and they're just attacking for a ping apiece. Now your opponent definitely will not block those guys, because, you know, they'll take more damage if they block them. So, again, in these artifact aggro decks that are just trying to attack with as many dudes at the same time as possible, now we have a dude that gives itself a little, like, mini cranial plating if it's unblocked, and now we have this thing that makes your dudes, like, punish your opponent when they do block them. So I really like both of these cards an awful lot, and I do think that there are actual decks they could really go in. I think that Cyberman Patrol looks a little funny. Look at his little suit and his little helmet. He looks so silly, but like, I don't know, that's one of the things I love about him. I think let's take a look at number 8. Why don't we do that? I think it's the point of this list. It's Vashta Narada. This is 3 mana, 2 and a black for a 1/1 alien horror with indestructible. It also has Shadow. Haven't seen that in 30 years, literally. Basically, it can only be blocked by creatures with Shadow. The trade-off there is that it can also only block creatures with Shadow. It has Morbid. What are we doing? At the beginning of each end step, if a creature died this turn, put a +1/+1 counter on Vashta. So again, Morbid ability that we don't see every day or in the past decade, you know. Actually, we have seen it in the past decade, but still. Old abilities on this thing, but that's again one of the things that makes me like it an awful lot. Look at these three abilities. Look at this. First of all, Indestructible Shadow. I'm kind of already on the boat. You know, I don't even care where we're going. I'm just I bought a ticket for the ferry. I want to see where it ends up because this is a really, really sweet looking card with just those two abilities combined. But yeah, if any creature died under any player's control, it's not a creature you control. Just if any creature died at all on the whole commander table, it gets a +1/+1 counter, and it's each end step too. It's not just like the beginning of your end step or something like that. If anything, just one last thing about this card. This is one of the few cards in like the bottom 5 of this list that I would consider cubing. A lot of the cards in the bottom 5 are just like commander only, like pretty strictly, but this right here, yeah, this could go slot directly into a cube and be like one of the better cards in most cubes. What do you do about this? What do you do about this? You know what I mean? So I think this could actually be a sweet cube card, but let's keep it pushing here and move on to number 7, which is the only doctor on the entire list. Which one could it possibly be? I haven't flipped to it yet, so you're speculating. What's your favorite doctor? Let me know down there in the comments. There's a bunch of doctors. They all do cool stuff, but I really only wanted one for this list, which was actually kind of easy because I only truly like one of them, and it's the second doctor. This is 4 mana, 2, a white, and a blue for a 2/4 legendary Time Lord Doctor. Players, just all of them, have no maximum hand size. How civil of you is, at the beginning of your end step, each player may draw a card. Each opponent who does cannot attack you or permanent you control during the next turn. So that is really neat in these group hug kind of commander decks that like people keep insisting don't exist in my comment section whenever I bring them up. They're all like, "Ah, oh, Dev, you sweet summer child, believing." group hug is a thing. I've seen it with my eyes. Do you play it alongside cards like Holy Day so that when your opponent does decide to not draw the cards so they can't attack you, you just punish them for doing that? You know, just white fog effects and stuff like that. You could probably fit a few of in this deck and still kind of do what you want to do. The thing is, the card is open-ended enough to where you can do a whole bunch of stuff with it. You know what I mean? Like, you don't... This can be your commander without necessarily, like, anchoring you to any one strategy. And I tend to like commanders like that, right? So, I think this is really, really neat. But that's about where it starts and ends, is that being really, really neat. I like the players having a maximum hand size, not just you, you know? And I do like, this is going to be redundant to some players, you know, it's not going to matter. They already have a reliquary tower, who cares, you know? So it's not like you're really restricting yourself that much by letting everybody have it. And if this is out, I think people are going to be less likely to try to kill it because, like, I want to hold 12 cards in my hand, you know what I mean? So I think there's a lot of cool stuff about this, but it's the only doctor that I'm, like, that excited about. Now, number 6 is a card that, for some reason, Wizards put an X in its casting cost, and I just don't understand. It's the Cyber Controller. What? This is X, and then 2 blue and a black. For a 3/3 legendary artifact creature, it's a Cyberman. When the Cyber Controller enters the battlefield, each opponent mills X cards. Put all creature cards milled this way onto the battlefield face down under your control. There are 2/2 Cyberman artifact creatures. Other artifact creatures you control get +1/+1, so those guys are actually 3/3s. This, I don't know why this is X. I'm aware that there's already ways to, like, mill your opponent out for X equals, right, whatever you want. But this just seems like especially dangerous as a commander in some ways with, like, so many ways to get infinite mana. Just, like, you completely kill all of your opponents the moment you play this if you have infinite mana. It's just seems actually very easy to do. But I'm aware there are already commanders like that, I guess. There's already plenty of commanders like that. So I probably shouldn't be, like, alarmed or anything. But I do think it's really cool. I like how scalable it is. Very versatile, you know. If you have, like, 10 mana, it's amazing. If you have 5 mana, it's still, like, okay. You know, it's still all right. It's probably going to get you a couple of guys, you know, so whatever. So I just think this is pretty freaking boss. There's probably even ways, definitely even ways, now that I think about it, that even if you're not killing them off the mills, right, if you have ways of giving all of these tokens, like, haste or something, you're going to kill them that way. Like, very, very likely, you know. You put them all on, like, 20 cards left in their library. You get, like, 15, 20 guys, and then you just, like, go to town, man. So this dude looks really, really sweet to me. And he is, like, actually sort of cubable. Don't tell anybody I said that. But this is actually a halfway decent little cube card. But still, as a commander, and even just in the 99, I think it's a neat thing that... I'm interested in giving a shot, man. I don't know if it's as dangerous as I think it is, but it's definitely cool, no matter what. Now, I wanted to go ahead and flip to number 5 so you know how serious I am about this card, in case you're listening and not watching. It's the goodest boy in the set. It's K9 Mark 1, a single blue mana for a 1/1 legendary artifact creature robot dog. He's got a negative. As long as K9 Mark 1 is untapped, other legendary creatures you control have Ward 1. Okay. He's also got affirmative. This is a single blue and a colorless and tap. Target legendary creature cannot be blocked this turn. It's also got Doctor's Companion. So if you have a commander that is a doctor, this can also partner with it. So that's kind of neat. Altogether, I think this card is stupidly good. I think it's possible this card is just straight up dumb. Like, first of all, in, like, Joda commander decks, this is a great one drop, pretty obviously. Just anything that's going to give all your legendary dudes Ward 1 is great, but, like, in any game of commander, this is a decent one drop. You know, it's kind of hard sometimes for blue to find good one drop creatures, you know, especially depending on what you're doing with your commander. And this just drops directly into literally any commander deck because of this first ability and how cheap it is to get on the table. And also the second ability, which makes your commander unblockable. So just tailor made for commander. To be honest, this should probably be higher up the list, right? Because it may be, as far as commander is concerned, the most impactful blue one drop ever printed. Am I going too far when I say stuff like that? I'm not actually sure. I'm trying to think of more impactful blue one drops, and I'm sure that someone in the comments section will school me, but holy crap, this looks way up there on the list, if nothing else. If I'm wrong, I don't think I'm that wrong. So just a blowout of a card, man. It's not, like, super duper impactful, but for what's for the investment that you're putting into it, it is incredibly impactful at that mana cost. So Just, man, he gets all the pets and treats in the world. He is a good dog. Let's move on to number 4, and this is where I think I start having more commander-ish stuff to say about these cards. So dust off your beacons of creation, because it's time for Breston Monoptera Leader here. This is a 2 green and a white and X for a 0/0 legendary alien insect scout with flying. It enters the battlefield with X +1/+1 counters on it. But also, when it enters the battlefield, you create X 1/1 green and white alien insect creature tokens with flying. Whenever you attack with one or more insects, put a +1/+1 counter on each of them. So I think this is probably a better insect commander than Zask, who I love. I like insects. It's one of my favorite creature types. So I know a little bit about Zask, but I will say you lose black. You lose black if you want to play this guy instead of Zask, and that's not super great for some insect decks, right? But I think this dude is really, really cool. And again, he's a little bit more open-ended than he looks, right? Because you don't even have to be playing insects. You can just be playing, like, Selesnya tokens, and this guy's kind of all right, right, as a commander. Or even just in the 99. But I think as an insect commander, really interesting dude, man. You know, it's like, again, I think I've already said Beacon of Creation, but I just want to say it again, you know, but there's plenty of other stuff, that goes with this. Obviously, like, Scoot Swarm is the first thing that comes to everyone's mind, right? So, there's stuff like a Hornet Queen, I guess, too. You know, when it comes to Hornet Queen, the tokens it gives you already have flying. And I would much rather the tokens have flying in most cases, because if they have flying, I think they're more likely to get multiple +1/+1 counters over multiple turns. If you're just putting counters on, like, Scoot Swarm tokens, then a lot of them are probably going to die on blocks, right? So, but I guess if you're attacking with enough Scoot Swarm tokens on the ground, some of them are going to get through and get another token, another counter next turn. So I just really like this. I'm biased. I like insect commanders. I like insects as a creature type. So as soon as I saw this, I was like, ooh, and it's probably not, like, on anybody else's list, but I just think this is a really, really sweet option. Again, not just as a commander, but in the 99. And as a guy who likes insect commander, it'll be interesting to see, like, what white brings to the table in an insect deck, because it's really not something I've ever looked at before. But let's move into the top 3 here, where we've got some exciting stuff, dude. Like, Danny Pink, man. This is 4 mana, 3 and a blue for a 4/3 legendary human soldier advisor with mentor. Whenever it attacks, you put a +1/+1 counter on target attacking creature with less power. Creatures you control have, whenever one or more counters are put on this creature for the first time each turn, draw a card. What an exciting card, dude. I really think this should probably have one fewer point of power and one fewer in terms of its casting cost. I do think it should be like 2 and a blue. But I do think still this is a really, really powerful card, man, in a bunch of decks. Like, in Simic decks, it's kind of cute. With, like, Experiment Kraj, I think that's kind of cute. And, like, any Simic commander that puts +1/+1 counters on stuff, this is probably pretty good with. But there's a few of them. But it's also kind of good with, like, Toothy, I guess, in mono blue. Although, I'll also say that, yeah, it only triggers once each turn on Toothy, but Toothy at least gets, like, 2 +1/+1 counters because of this interaction. But the thing that I really can't wait to try it with is a thing you've never heard of, and it's Deka. And I think this is a really, really sweet card for Deka, dude, because, like, every time you cast an instant or sorcery, you'll get a fractal and you'll put the counters on it, and then this will draw you a card. I'm fairly certain that it will work that way. So, absolutely silly, I think, if you can. It's basically whenever you cast an instant or sorcery, draw a card. Which is pretty silly, I think. I'm fairly certain if that interaction works the way I want it to, then this is a ridiculous card. Either in the 99 of Deka, or, like, you play this as your commander and Deka's in your 99. But I'm pretty sure Deka's your commander, and you find this as quickly as possible, right? And Deka's a cool commander, like, regardless of you have Danny out or not. Like, she can function without Danny, but I've always thought Deka's an awesome commander. I like fractals. I like Magecraft as just an ability. And getting bodies for Magecraft is awesome. But when you're getting bodies and drawing cards, like, oh my God, let's go. So please let me know. I'm fairly certain that works the way I want it to, and I hope it does. But regardless of whether it does or not, I think Danny Pink is going to see play in a ton of commander decks just throughout its life cycle, right? Because +1/+1 counters get thrown around all the time. And if you get cards for those, like, yeah, sign me up, dude. It's an awesome thing. But anyway, let's move on to number 2 here. Which is going to be Displaced Dinosaurs. Look, at my heart, I am a Timmy, and I can't help that about myself. I'm going to be excited about this card, okay? And you can't stop me. It's 7 mana, 5 and 2 green for a 7/7 dinosaur. As a historic permanent enters the battlefield under your control, it becomes a 7/7 dinosaur creature in addition to its other types. Now, to refresh your memory, artifacts, legendaries, and sagas are historic. So, first of all, you play your commander, it becomes a 7/7 dinosaur, which is hilarious. But yeah, just artifacts. Just artifacts. It's any artifact. Enters the battlefield, not when you cast or blah, blah, blah. Enters the battlefield like an artifact. It doesn't say non-token or anything like that. So, just create like... Wait, am I going to say Urtet again? Is this another card for Urtet? Kind of. That guy's getting some work in this in this set. It's just a good card. But yeah, like any sort of little like dinky artifact tokens or like 1 and 2 mana artifacts that you just like storm onto the table, you know what I mean? You just get a bunch of 7/7 dinosaurs, dude. I get that this costs 7 mana. I get that it's fragile just because it's a creature. You know, it dies to removal, whereas like an enchantment that did this wouldn't as often, theoretically. Add some qualifiers to that. But still, even with that, again, you can't stop me. If I play an artifact, it's just a 7/7. I play a Felwar Stone, it's a 7/7. I play Sol Ring, it's a 7/7. If I play Sol Ring, it's a 7/7. And I tap that to play a Felwar Stone, and that's a 7/7. I can't do that, actually, because it's a creature. And so it can't tap the turn it comes into play. That's a downside. But it's not enough of a downside to get me to not like the card. I mean, like, everything I play is a dinosaur? Yes, I'm 5. Let me play with this card. But all right, we got one more card to look at. But you know what? I gotta say, I'm a little bit tired. Like I said, my throat hurts and all that. I've been sick this week. I think before we get to number one, I need to sit back for just a little bit, put my feet up, open a magazine, get myself a nice little mug, have myself a coffee break. This week on the coffee break, the cards from this set that I hate. It's not a word that I like to use very often, but there are cards that I completely loathe from this very set, and I feel like I have to adopt the coffee break voice so that I do not raise my blood pressure when talking about them. For instance, the card Everybody Lives is in this set and was printed for some reason. Someone designed it, everyone else okayed it, and it was sent to the printer, and it fits under an Isochron Scepter, and we may never know why. Another card I hate from this set is Trenzalore Clock Tower. This is a nearly strictly better island that comes into play untapped and creates a blue mana. But if you have a doctor, it can also just cast a version of Time Twister. Why does it do that? I do not know. Did you know that this card is not part of a cycle? It is simply a blue, untapped legendary land that lets you refresh your hand for only 2 mana. Why does it exist? It is absolutely ludicrous. And finally, not only one of my least favorite cards from this set, but perhaps one of my most hated cards of all time upon first reading it, Everything Comes to Dust. This guy, hey, it's me again. Let me pull away from the coffee break stuff and just say why is this? Okay, first of all, Everything Comes to Dust is in this set. This blows away everything and exiles it. This exiles everything. All those stuff. It exiles basically everything. Did you know they also reprinted Farewell in this set? Did you know they did that? They also, into this set, printed a card called Crisis of Conscience, which also destroys like all non-land permanents. What are you doing? I don't know how many people have to tell you on like Reddit and Facebook and X, don't call it X, Twitter, just everywhere. I don't know how many content creators have to say it, that Farewell is the dumbest card that you've ever printed. It's the most hated commander card of all time. I see this take on Twitter literally every day, and it's a take I've made myself. And when I made, you know, the number one card I would ban in standard, Farewell, everyone in the comment section was like, yeah, dude, I hate Farewell. I play commander and I hate Farewell. Like, everyone has been trying to tell you for months now that Farewell was a mistake, and you just print another one. You just print another one. You're like, whoops, go print another one. Then why are you doing that? Why are you printing a second Farewell? Do you want people to like stop playing Commander? Is that what it is? Or no, play Standard. I remember you had that plan to get people to play Standard again. Is it just going to get people to stop playing Commander? Is that what you're doing? You're just printing another Farewell. And what are you doing? I don't understand. So let's bring my blood pressure down and talk about a card I do like, okay? Because there are a few different like awesome looking copy, like clone cards in this set. Like flesh duplicate, right? Looks awesome. Just two mana for a clone, you know, phantasmal image, that kind of thing. I think that's what card's called. Zygon Infiltrator. You know, it costs a little bit more, but it can, you know, copy creatures turn over turn. I think that's really, really cool. It can copy a different guy this turn. These cards look awesome. But my favorite of all of these, by far, is Nanogene Conversion. This is, by the way, in my brother-in-law's family, there's a person named Nanny Gene. So I always, whenever I see this card, I think of Nanny Gene Conversion. This is 4 mana, 3 and a blue for a sorcery. Choose target creature you control. Each other creature becomes a copy of that creature until end of turn, except it isn't legendary. Now, note how this is worded. Each other creature on the whole table. Not just creatures you control. Every single creature becomes a copy of that creature till end of turn. Lots of ways you can use and abuse this, man. Even though it's symmetrical, there's actually ways you can use the symmetry to your advantage. Like you copy any 0/0 creature. Right, like a walking ballista, let's say. Copy a 0/0. And then look at that. All the creatures that don't have +1/+1 counters on them are dead now. So that's, you can kind of use it as a wrath effect if you have a 0/0 out. First of all, it works really well with just like anything that has attacks triggers in its color combination. So Raphine is one that I've seen a bunch of people kind of throw around there, and that one makes sense. If all your creatures are Raphines, then you're going to get a lot of connive triggers. It's going to be very disgusting, but there's also, let me look at my book, stuff like Svelian, whose name I have been saying since 1995, and I still don't really know that I'm pronouncing it right, but Svelian looks really, really good with this. You know, you're drawing a bunch of cards, first of all, and there's other cool stuff that happens as well. There's also Vargas Wrath, turns your guys all into Vargas Wrath. They're all pirates, so they attack, and they all get +1,000,000, +1,000,000. That seems pretty gross. Kaikar. This doesn't have an attacks trigger or anything, but it is a neat one because with Kaikar, you can make a bunch of little dudes and then turn all your guys, all those little guys that you made, into Kaikars, and then swing over for 1,000,000. And it's, since all your guys are Kaikars, now you can cast instants and sorceries and get 1,000,000 1/1s and swing with them. So that also seems very disgusting. Geist of St. Traft is another one that can be your commander, and now all your dudes are Geists, so they all swing in and make 4/4 flyers. That's... which actually is super dumb because every creature on the board is a 2/2 hexproof that's on the ground, right? So if all your Geists of St. Traft swing in, all the 4/4s that fly are getting in. So that's kind of cute. Grimgrin. Grimgrin is probably like one of the most busted things you can actually do with this card. So there's a lot of stuff. I'm not even done here. My book has more stuff. There's Euro. All your Euros are attacking and drawing you cards and gaining you life and stuff. And then Lord Xander is the last thing I have written down, which is a pretty funny one too, actually. Pretty excited about it. I think I've talked about it enough, and maybe I've talked you into it. But that is Itsky Lewitsky. Just let me know what your favorite Doctor Who cards are, because there's a ton of them. There's actually a lot of really sick-looking cards in this set, and I've never seen a single episode of Doctor Who in my life. I mean, I know about like Daleks and Time Lords and the Sonic Screwdriver, and like, I know some stuff just from like participating in pop culture and nerd culture and all that stuff, but I know what the TARDIS is. It's right there on the screen. I know certain things, but I've never sat down and watched any. I know nothing about the lore. It seems cool, you know. It seems like it doesn't take itself too seriously, sort of the humor of a Hitchhiker's Guide mixed with the, you know, a universe that, again, doesn't take itself seriously, but still has this sort of rigid rule set the way like Star Trek does. Maybe I'm looking far too far into it, but still, like, just what I can glean about the show, it looks like a cool show. I've just never made the time to watch it, but the cards you see, they actually look pretty sick from this set. A lot of them do. So just let me know what your favorite ones are in the comments section. Anything I missed, combos, interactions, commanders you can't wait to play with, whatever. And then do all the other stuff on your way out. You know, like, subscribe, hit up the Patreon, link in the description. Check out the Twitch, free to follow over there. Hoping to get some more followers, trying to get to 10K. We're actually not that far away. So help us out over on Twitch, link in the description for that too. And more content coming up very soon. But check out some of our other content. Just put out this Orzhov Tokens Reanimator deck. the other day, brand new archetype, hybridization of two types that shouldn't go together. It really works. It's a fun deck. We're Hughes's Moonshaker Cavalry. Nobody watched it. Go watch that deck tech. I'm actually really proud of it. Check it out. Anyway, aside from that, I'm donezo for this one, so I'll catch you cats later. I'm Deb from the place. Thanks for watching, Wizards. Spread love and be kind.